tell us everything about the Beastie Boys.
Oh, yeah, I'll give you all the dirt.
Just between us.
Yeah, I'll kill him.
Oh, sorry.
Actually, I won't have to. They'll kill it. Well, you know, sci-fi. You know what a pain in the ass sci-fi is. You can't say anything. You can't say anything about anybody. Everybody's dead. Warehouse 13, season 4. Everybody's dead. That's what the poster should be. I'd watch that, wouldn't you?
Was it hard for you to come up with how to follow up?
No, actually, I knew how it was going to end. I mean, I knew the solution when we pitched it, and I actually pitched the next episode last year to Mark Cernan, and he said, no, save that. Just blow up the warehouse at the end of the season. Oh, okay. Save me having to run out. Now I know what season 4, episode 1 is, so we're good. You know, I was all ready to go. No, I knew how we could get out of this corner. I had a way all planned. But, you know, then getting beyond that, and what's cool about this year is the way we deal with this problem that we created creates an even bigger problem. Creates an emotional dangerous arc for Artie that he follows all year long. It puts him head-to-head with Brent Spiner all year, and it culminates in a really cool... I'm so excited about this season. I think it's the most exciting season yet, because it's really emotional, and I think, you know, having established and built this family and make them really care about each other, now the cool thing is that it's great to love, it's great to have a family, but what happens when danger steps into that? What happens when your family's at risk? You know, what happens when something really awful happens in your family? How do you deal with it? How does a family deal with mortality? How does a family deal with loss, with fear? And it brings them closer together. The whole season is very emotional. The first episode is like an Indiana Jones episode to me. It's like National Treasure meets Indiana Jones, and not Crystal Skull, the good ones. and it's even though, you know, I have to say I enjoy Crystal Skull.
Oh no, I know, but still
anything with him in it. And then we build season 2. I think the most emotional, powerful moments we've had this year, with episodes 9 and 10, I think are the most powerful moments we've ever done on the show. It's just really great. And it's just our guys. You know, it's just our gang. But the way they have to deal with it all is just really incredibly powerful.
How hard is it to make us laugh and cry at the same time? Well, we do a lot more like this.
Yeah, I think, and you know what? I have a great writing staff. I have a magnificent cast that can do that. It's really hard, you know, because sometimes it would be an incredibly dangerous moment, and I'll have a joke in the script, and sometimes I get a note saying, is that the right time for a joke? And like, yes. That's actually the only time for the joke. When the knife is at your throat, that's when you do the joke. Because that's when it's the most powerful. That's when it makes you laugh the hardest. That's when it surprises you. That oh my God, he made a joke. You know, they're hanging by ropes, you know, and they're going to make a joke. And that to me is the great... The joy of this show is that we can do that. You know, the other jokes are just jokes. You can just do a joke in the moment. But this is like, humor is what gets them through their day. Yeah, exactly. It's how Pete and Micah and all of them can get through. It's how they get through. It's how they live in this crazy world of insanity. And so, but because they can turn on a dime, I mean, I think in the first episode, you're gonna be laughing and crying all the way through it. And these guys, a second episode too. It's just a really cool. What's going on?
Poor werewolves and vampires. Come on, man.
The place is filling up with
costume. How much
research artifacts? A lot. Yes, I'm really tough on the writers about that. I'm just saying, don't. If anybody ever makes something up, I will wring their necks. We it all has to be based on absolute truth. Now we can bend the truth and play with it and come up with things because. You know, H.G. Wells is not a woman, but you have to know everything about it before you break the rules. You have to understand it intensely. It's like Robert McKee's story structure, like understand all the story before you can break the rules. You got to understand the rules before you can break the rules. So we really research everything thoroughly, as much as Wikipedia allows. Thank God for Wikipedia. The internet. Oh my God! Can you imagine? I spend all day in the library. Reading the books.
Jack, I don't mean to grab that question, sorry, but we asked Jamie Murray if, you know, if she would still do a film, if she would actually let you do the Defiance now. She said, "Yeah, same network, same city."
Sure,
I mean, I do it.
It's all sci-fi. I think, you know, it's a dangerous proposition to get into a prequel and a period piece. I mean, those are dangerous things because it's expensive. You know, it's to create 1890s anywhere is expensive, much less on a regular weekly basis. It's just, it wouldn't really be a prequel. It would be, yeah, I guess it would be a prequel, because, but it wouldn't have anything to do with Warehouse 13. It would still be, have artifacts, and it would also be Sherlock Holmesy, and I'd love to do it. I mean, we have an outline, it's all ready to go. It's just a question of where sci-fi, there's just a certain amount of resources that can be placed, and now Jamie's on the plane, so we'll just see. You know, I hope you find some huge hit. The trailer looks great.
It looks great, yeah, that's really good.
Yeah, so, you know, here's hoping. I think they need another hit. So it'd be good to be part of a bunch of hits. Yeah. Anybody else?
Nobody's asking questions. I'm 50.
As long as I'm not holding anybody up.
No, don't pull you. Don't worry. So Brent Spiner, like, what was the idea of casting him? Like, did you want Brent Spiner? Did he become? I mean,
I love Brent Spiner. I mean, and you know, I don't have the same relationship to Brent that everybody else has. I saw him play John Adams in 1776 on Broadway, and I was like, I love this guy. He's great, and he's a tremendously nice guy. Really easy to work with. A lot of fun. A lot of ideas. And no, it's just a question of, we knew we were creating this role. Brother Adrian is going to be sort of a nemesis for Artie, and I knew that Saul and Brent were really close friends. And I said, so what would you think about this? And Saul was like, oh my God, that would be a dream come true. And they just had the greatest time.
The first time on screen in like 20 years.
Yeah,
ago.
Yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Yeah, and they're like, they are really close friends. And they talk all the time.
So, and Brent,
he's great fun. Yeah, he's a tremendous actor, and it was a great coup for us, a great catch, and he's just so much fun. Yeah, it worked out really well.
But it's not like a conspiracy to bring every Star Trek actor over, though, right?
Not on my part, no. I mean, there's a certain part of the Star Trek repertory company that every sci-fi show goes to. I mean, I'm sure if Leonard Nimoy was available, we'd have him on the show. You know, I don't know that he is. Actually, I pitched Michelle for something first season, which wasn't available. Second season, yeah. I met her on the picket line during the WGA. It's all who you know.
It sounds like it was an easy process to bring in Brent because of the person that he is. But what kind of a challenge to, I guess, storytelling dynamic to write in a character that's going to have such a major
It's fun, and it's, I mean, they bring so much to the table already because of their relationship, because of their current relationship, so it, you can write towards a lot of that challenging. I mean, although I kid Saul and Brent both, sometimes it becomes a contest in pausing. I mean, guys, come on, I got 43 minutes to do this show. I can't spend 8 of them pausing. They're very, you know, intense actors. But no, it was easy. It was fun to write Brent to the show, because he was, he was just there to torture Artie. He wants something out of Artie, and he's going to torture Artie until he gets it. And so it's just a question of Brother Adrian going after Artie, and he'll go to any length. And it's really kind of fun. Yeah.